Coffee Gang.
Time for Hot Topics, and our Hot Topics, we get to talk about stuff that, you know, affects everybody. You know, trending topics that are making the rounds everywhere in the country, not just the papers, on social media, all that. And today we're talking about the U.S. visa ban on Nigeria. Yes, it's been in the news for weeks now. So I'm asking, is it a good way of telling the Nigerian government to fix up? Is it a good way to tell them that they need to fix up?
Yeah. Now, this came out because just yesterday, you know, we just got word that the United States government has revealed that it notified all foreign governments of the change in its performance metrics for identity management and information sharing criteria since, get this, March 11th, 2019.
Yeah, Dami, hold that thought. We have a caller. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning. What's your name and where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Lekki Phase 1. My name is Kunle.
All right, Kunle, really quickly, what's your point?
Yeah, it's high time we sat down. Mm. It's so sad and it's so terrible to be listed among the black, to be on the blacklist.
The blacklist, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Many people travel for greener pasture. Many people travel for business. Many people travel for different purposes and different reasons. But honestly, if we are made, we have all it takes, but it's not all about the government. It's all about you and I. You and I need to fix this country. I have the opportunity to live abroad, but I choose to live in Nigeria. I'm doing my business, and I have over 45 staff that I pay salary monthly, mm-hmm. and sometimes I'm frustrated. Mm. You know, the biggest pain is some months back, September 27, mobile policemen gone armed with fully armed.
Okay.
Lagos judiciary court staff and touts, like almost 50 touts.
Okay.
Came to our office in Lekki Phase 1 and they said everybody should vacate the premises within 8 hours. They didn't give us quick notice, they didn't give us anything. This is a business I've been building for almost 10 years. We are all asked to move out. And they said they have court injunction. My brother, we have to move out. My neighbor downstairs, they were trying to like, no, we can't do this, you can't do that. The mobile policeman gets on them, beats them like, you guys paid 50,000 naira to bail those guys. Because they said we're taking them to court. And when we tell them to court, that's to Kirikiri straight up. So we're forced, we're compelled to move. This is how business dies in Nigeria. Mm. I've labored, I've suffered, I school abroad, I came back to Nigeria to start up my business. I have staff that I train, that I employ, that I empower. All of a sudden, they just came and they just want to mess up my business. I had no choice. What I did was, okay, got a big trailer. We moved everything I have down to OPIC. Mm. That's where my brother lives in the U.S., has a building there. He moved from Lekki Phase 1 to OPIC. Whoever hears this story will know who is talking. Okay. We moved down to OPIC, all the way to OPIC. From Lekki Phase 1 to OPIC, that's where we operated for like a week. Now I have to look for money all around and all that. Got a new place, a bigger, better space. What if I don't have that money? Mm. What if I can't raise 7 something million to pay rent in Lekki Phase 1? That is how this business will die. So it's tough. You know, doing business in Nigeria is crazy.
It really
government
is.
Government policy
is
pretty crazy.
Yeah,
and
you're
all
right.
That.
Yeah.
Okay, so are you for the visa ban or are you against the visa ban or are you for it? Like, you know, U.S. banning Nigeria?
No. What I'm saying is, if you pay yourself right, they won't place you on the ban.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Coming. You remember they took us out of the what's it called? The visa lottery.
Yeah. A long time ago.
That's where it started. Mm. They said, no, you guys are not eligible to do visa lottery again. They took us out of visa lottery. Now there's another ban. It's so sad.
It is.
That is to begin at home.
It
we
really
have
is.
To fix our home.
Absolutely.
When we fix our home, they will bet to do business with us.
Absolutely. All right. Thank you so much
Thank
for calling.
Thank you so much.
That's
Thank
what I'm saying.
All Thank right. you so much.
Thank
have
you.
A good day. Take it easy.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot. So basically what we were saying is they had... The breakdown of the story is basically they had a whole year you know. The requirements was, you know, the U.S. government in proclamation published at the White House website that, you know, Nigeria and five other affected countries were amongst the worst performing in the world.
Wow.
It stated that, the progress began on March 11th to 2019 when the United States government formally notified all foreign governments except for Iran, Syria, and North Korea about the refined performance metrics for identity management and information sharing criteria. And DHS identified the worst performing countries for further interagency review and for assessment of the potential impact of visa restrictions. In addition, the U.S. government, led by the Department of State, continued to increase an engagement with many countries and those countries' deficiencies. So they basically said, here's a bit of time for you to step up.
Exactly.
You know, I think I keep saying it all the time. We are a reaction country, not a proaction country, because Buhari just set up a committee to study and address the issues that made the U.S. suspend the issuance of immigration visas to Nigerian passport holders. They had since March last year to set up this committee done before it was finalized.
You're right. Hello, good morning.
Good morning, everybody in the studio.
All right, good morning. What's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Akani Nunu.
Ah, Akani Nunu. All right, in under 2 minutes, what's your contribution?
My contribution is the ban should stay the way it is. Right? So we can fix, first of all, we can fix our healthcare system. We can fix our insurance system. Because the level of corruption, all the while we're crying, now, these are ways they're trying to tell us that you people have enough resources, fix your country.
Okay.
I think the UK should be extended to the UK, because I want to see where they will be going for health care. Under whose expense. Right? So they should fix up this country. It's not a bad thing anyway. But for those who are doing business, I know they will not go with the, you know, this is not a good thing for them, because it's really going to affect their business. But I think the Nigerian government representatives, right, only think for themselves how they would benefit for these 4 years, and then it doesn't affect other people. But you still expect these people to come and bring tax pay tax.
It's not necessarily about, you know, them going for healthcare. That's the reason they are banning it, though. It's because they,
this is my contribution from
where
I think it is affecting a lot of people.
Okay.
Because, there are a lot of people who you see that a lot of humanitarian workers that come from the U.S. to Nigeria to help people. So they are looking at it from every angle, especially corruption, and then neglecting the people who elected you there to help them fix that. If U.S. was like Nigeria, who would be rushing down to go to U.S.? So it's a way of telling them to fix this country up, or stay where you are. Manage your. They say if you get friend, you will know how to manage and or you let go.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I think a lot of people are getting it wrong in terms of, you know,
why they banned it.
Yeah, not even that. Just the type of visas that are.
Okay. Yeah. True.
Yeah, because there is, like, you can still get a visa, but only for tourism, student travel, and business travel. So not necessarily long extended stays. So that's actually what it is. You can still get a visa if you want to go on holiday. You can still do that.
You finish your halls, you come back.
You come back.
You understand? Don't stay back doing anything. It sounds like, really, I mean, you won't blame them if actually, you know, should I say banning us with the immigration visas if you check it. You know, we don't have any, we don't have any database, basically.
Yeah.
Information. We don't have information, like, of any citizen if you check it.
People are undocumented.
Exactly. So, like, they are just saying that we are not adequately, you know, up to standard in terms of public safety and terrorism-related information.
That's right. You know what? We'll be right back right after this. Coffee Gang. That's right. We are the Coffee Gang, and we are live right here on Hot 93.3. And we are on Hot Topics this morning, where we are talking about the U.S. ban on Nigeria and issuing Nigeria visas, basically. And we have a caller. Hello. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning. My name is Yomi from Ijesha.
All right. Good morning, Yomi.
Good morning. You see what happened? There is not a slap to Nigeria. and it's a slap to our leader in this country. Not long before Nigeria can be banned of entering America, you know what it means for the whole world. If we make our home, mean that we don't have skeleton in our combat, I see no reason why we should be banned. The blame should go to our leaders, and this will make Nigeria to know where we belong to. You understand? There is no country that are corrupt, and that poverty will not be lingering. You see what happened in Lagos recently when they banned Okada and Marwa? What does that one imply? It's to create poverty for the people. People that are managing from the Marwa, from Okada, people they laid off from organization and they gather money, hire purchase, buy this thing to manage their family. If you see how people are walking, trekking from Kostin to Ujuelegba to all these places yesterday, it's worrisome. Our leaders should not cause anarchy in this country. Because this thing, one day, when it will happen, they will not be able to withstand it. It's even good. Now that nobody can get out of this country, even you are billionaire, you are multi-billionaire, you cannot get out of anywhere. I even want UK to ban Nigeria, even Canada to ban Nigeria.
Bros, calm down.
Then you understand. It's very terrible now. One person will have $1 billion in their account. Why some people are suffering? If you see the kind of cracking people are cracking students, Abuja, Surulere, there is no public secondary, government secondary school there. And you ban Marwa, look at those young boys that are coming on their way. You put them in sovereignty. You have never put anything in place for to cushion the fact of what we are going to do. What type of government are we having? It's even good that America ban Nigeria. Let UK ban Nigeria. Let Canada ban Nigeria. So that our leader will not have where to go and stay. When it will happen, Nigeria, let us face it together.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
He said a lot there.
People won't be happy if all that country is banned us. We are still lamenting about the US. You can imagine if Canada, UK, and other countries, that doesn't speak all of our country, then it's not good at all, even for our businesses. As in, they'll look at us in under light. Like, if all these countries are banning you, other countries would look like, okay, is it that bad down here?
You know what it is, though? It is that bad. That's the problem. I think we've put this mask on for so long that, you know, we make Nigeria look so good, especially in the entertainment industry and all that. Nigeria looks so amazing and you want to come and everything. And we are an amazing country, but, you know, the stuff that is going on the underbelly is rising to the surface now. And I feel like it's a little bit of tough love. You know what I mean? Like, maybe this, because a lot of the times the stuff that's been happening hasn't affected our government officials and people in, you know, in the power. Now this affects them. So maybe this will make them fix up. Will push them to actually make the country better and make not just have a facade that we look good, but actually be good, you know?
Well, you know, like, you know, them coming from the angle of, you know, inadequate public safety and terrorism-related information, it makes sense. Okay, check when the attack on Iran happened, the Soleimani attack, and, you know, we had people in Nigeria protesting, you know, the shites against something that has to do with Iran and the U.S., Now, would you blame them if they are concerned about, you know, terrorism-related information?
That's right. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning. My name is Sunday.
All right, good morning, Sunday.
I just want you guys to help us clarify for some of our listeners who don't really know what this ban is all about. So it's not like they are banning
us from
Nigeria
going there.
The last caller should know that all the rich guys can still get to the U.S. whenever they want to. In fact, this ban will affect poor people more if people do not know.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you have a good record, you've been going to the U.S. and you have a good record, the chances that you'll be denied will be very slim. It's going to affect first-timers more.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to affect people. You know, it's just going to... So what's going to happen basically is they will reduce the rate at which visas are being given.
Yeah.
If you are going to be given a visa, you must be some. In fact, if you are rich, the more likely that you will get a visa because they know you're not going to come to constitute a nuisance there.
True.
That's just one part. So the second part I want to talk about is the fact that I like the way the visa has been banned because you can't imagine my national ID card I registered for it since 2014, and I've not even gotten it.
A lot of people have that same story. I don't know why. Yeah. It's crazy. Yeah. We don't understand.
So the system is so messed up. Nothing works. Then again, the U.S. are saying that our security protocols are very loose and porous.
It's poor.
Which means that they can't guarantee that a terrorist will not just go and get a Nigerian passport
and come into their country.
And go to the U.S. and blow himself up. You get, because you see bribery everywhere. People just drive their ways through. So we have very poor security protocols. That's just a summary of what the U.S. are trying to do. And this is just something very easy to fix. Get a national database, give people their national ID cards, and fix these things up. It's just simple.
Exactly.
So people who are saying that they don't ban and ban and ban, it's not like that. You know, they just, they identified a problem and they want us to fix it. So this, this has nothing to do with corruption. It has nothing to do with anything. It's just our security protocols.
Needs to be updated.
We need to fix it.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Like, I mean, it's not like you can't go to America. You can't go. But, you know, those looking to, like, people that want to relocate, spend more time there, it affects the poor more than the rich, actually. Those that have been traveling will still travel. You understand? But, you know, like, we really need to have that database, like he just said. I mean, nobody has any record in Nigeria. Someone can go to prison and come outside and tell you that he never served time, he never did time, and you, there's no record to show. Only if you go to the prison and maybe the courts maybe start asking, but there is no database that, you know, they can check to know that if it's updated or not.
Exactly.
Like, you understand? So that's the thing, like, we need to update the database and check when the whole protest happened in Abuja. Protest, something that has to do with Iran and the U.S.
Exactly. I remember we said it, we covered it here on the show, and we said, listen, burning the U.S. flag and all of this is going to have consequences.
Right now, we are concerned. Okay.
Hello.
Hello, good morning.
Hello, sorry, good morning. Please, I just wanted to appreciate the last caller for, you know, I think I was found wanting in that also. I just wanted to say thank you because I think we just jumped, you know, probably put on our radio and then we just hear, you know, the headlines and then we started contributing. So I just wanted to thank him for, you know, putting more clarification on what the discussion is so that it doesn't seem like we just have, we just call to talk as if because we're free to call. I just wanted to say I just wanted to say thank you to him and thank you to you guys also.
All right.
Thank you. Yeah, it's just that thing of, you know, the country is in disarray right now, and it and we keep, like I said, we keep pushing it down and pushing it down, and just like we said earlier in the mail, where we're just like, oh, they do this, and we just take it, and we're just like, oh, we'll deal with it. But now we really have to tackle things because the world is watching. We are a global village now. The things that are happening all over. The way we're seeing it, everyone else in the world is seeing it. Nobody wants to, nobody wants that kind of country to be affiliated with them. You know what I mean? Because the way people see it, bad news travels faster than good news, right?
And
so when you see something bad happen in a country, you're like, well, they must be like that. We don't want them here.
And what they're actually trying to achieve that.
So in conclusion, the government should provide for the people. Protest is good, yes, but we cannot protect and pray. For how long are we going to do all this? God should stop budging himself for the things we can solve. So I think if the government provides for the people, if there's food, if there's job, if there's money, if there's no poverty, this situation will be a thing of the past.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
You see, what about processing that? Sometimes, as much as we always say protest, you know, the government will listen. There's always one selfish person there that has a hidden agenda. Like, a lot of times you see protests being led by people, like people that spearhead the protest. They always, have a political career. They always have something they're trying to benefit from the protest. So they use the lives or bloods of innocent people to climb up the political ladder. Did you get? Hello?
Yeah, there's a lot of people that are like that. Hello, good morning.
Yeah, good morning. This is Arnold calling from Lekki.
All right, Arnold. Go ahead.
I want to make some, like, a little contribution concerning the, that female caller before this last caller.
Yeah?
She was talking about that why would they not protest? Why would they not fight? Do you know that if this same regime has added been, they call it a protest, there was destruction and all of that, it will still be that same woman or other person that would call that this is what the church put up, true or false. If you can remember during, is it 2 years now, or last 2 years or so, when two friends wanted to protest, when you call it a protest, what happened? A night before the protest, he called it
off.
Because of the threat and cause he had, is that not so?
Yeah.
Now, this regime, I believe that the Adeboye is a wise
man and a real man of God. He used wisdom, he applied wisdom. If you see the prayer walk, if there was nothing like distraction, there was nothing like fighting, there was nothing like police harassing one or two person, right?
Yeah.
Do you know why like that? Because they took everybody unaware. They took the politicians unaware, they took the talks unaware, the touts. Had it been that they made an announcement that we're having a prayer walk, it is a protest. Those touts also will put on suits, come outside to scatter that protest. Mm. That is where you see they start stealing from the road, start stealing, start fighting, discharging or fighting the police. Even the police may even come out to the stop because mm-hmm. they call it a protest. I don't think they're trying to
they
get
called it
a,
yeah.
But
I understand.
They call it a prayer walk. A prayer walk. It has started. Now, if you see almost everybody, now your line is hotline. Everybody are calling towards contribute and comment. Because this is the message that the pastor wanted to bring us, the communication that mm-hmm. the Christian, we are not sleeping. This is the first step. I don't know if you get.
Mm-hmm.
If it's wisdom, we can only use wisdom to tackle our government. How long have we been protesting? Even if we should start protesting now, how many people will come outside to fight? Everybody will run inside their house. Why the rich will fly out of the country? That is just a fact. It is only wisdom. And this is the first step of the wisdom. By coming out, taking them unaware, the protest has gone a long way. If you check the news now, maybe CNN, probably, it may be online that ROCC, they did a prayer walk. You see social media, they're posting some statues online and all of that. Have it been, they call it a protest, some evil head will still come out to spoil it. And they will put the blame on that. They are debating that this is what the church brought out.
All right.
Because you are the first. I don't know.
I get your point, though. I get your point. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You know, he's right. He said that, maybe he disguised it as a prayer walk because, maybe just to have the peace. You can't really, when you look at it in the media, I think the government will realize that they even look bad if you try to dismantle a prayer walk. Mm. People are literally praying and walking in peace.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? You can't disrupt something like that.
I think the church went about this in the wisest way possible. And mm-hmm. I use wise for a reason. But I think we have a call. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
My name is Chimedu. I'm calling from Ikoyi.
Okay, go ahead.
You guys are actually doing. I just tuned in now, though. I just left the house and I just tuned in and I listened to one or two people call.
Yeah.
And I picked interest. It's a wonderful topic you guys are really talking about this morning.
Thank you so much. Go ahead.
The truth is, Christians in Nigeria, I think we've lost this word called Christian in Nigeria, because our so-called leaders and Christians, the ones we know, they don't know their job. They're not doing what they're supposed to do as Christians that they call themselves. Understand? Because I don't see the reason why a man of God should involve himself in anything that has to do with politics or governmental issues.
But don't you think that these issues...
Same land first.
Okay, go on.
Finish up.
Let me not go into deep about that one. Let me not talk about this security issue we have in Nigeria.
Mm-hmm.
The truth is that our government have failed us, especially this current government that we have now. They failed us woefully.
Okay.
The rate of crime that we have in this country now is so annoying.
Okay. Abuna,
when you travel by road like this, Sagamu, the new Jebode road, you will see what people are going through on that road every day.
Okay.
November last year, I was kidnapped on that road.
Oh, wow.
Me, myself. November on that, me, my younger brother, and my cousin brother, we were traveling to my sister's traditional marriage. We were kidnapped on that road for 4 days.
Hmm.
And people that kidnapped us were military men, putting on uniforms.
Maybe they were terrorists disguised as military men, because I don't think...
They were putting on uniform and they were carrying a helo that has Nigerian army written on it. They stopped us, they sacked us. I brought out my phone. They were searching my phone. After searching my phone, one of them asked me how old I am. I told him I'm 36 years. He said 36 years and I'm using a phone of 600 or something. So I said, what is the meaning of that? I'm doing a legitimate job. To have a small boy like me using a phone of 600 and something thousand, and him that is standing on the sun, his phone is not even up to 20,000. The next thing I said, the next thing he speaks to the guy, he said, wow, everyone want to go?
Wow.
I was surprised. After 4 days, the family has to pay
$4.9 million to get us out.
Whoa,
that's crazy. Well,
sorry about your experience. That's
we're glad you're okay.
We're glad you're okay, but I really still doubt those are military men. Maybe they're just disguised as military men, you know, with because I mean, that's why military men always have issues with people putting on camouflage so that they can actually identify those that are for them and those that are not for them. But I'm sorry about
it. Okay, my brother, I agree with you. Maybe they are just people.
They're just disguised. That yes.
Understand, disguised. I agree with you on that. I agree with you. Yesterday, I went to Badon. Understand? I went to Badon. On our way coming back from Badon yesterday, Nigerian police force stopped us. My mom was in the car. They stopped us. I stopped. They said, where is your license? I give them my license. They said, who is this girl? The woman there is my mom. They asked my mom to come down. They started searching the car. They searched the car. There was nothing there. They collected my phone. They were searching. Someone used to see Yoruba and tell the other one that she searched that phone well, that I look like a Yahoo boy.
Wow.
Understand? I looked at it in my lab. I have shown you guys my ID card, what I do for a living. You guys have seen my ID card. Even my school ID card is in Ukraine. You've seen my school ID card in Ukraine. The business I do here in Nigeria, you've seen the ID card. Everything I do for a living, you've seen the ID.
Oh, sorry about all your experiences. Hello.
For me, in presence of my mom, they collected $10,000 to leave us. In presence of my mom. What are we saying? This country is just so annoying. This country, everything in this country is not working. The government, our leaders are not working. Our so-called security people are not working. This country is doomed. I'm sorry to say this. I think I've lost hope in Nigeria.
Don't lose hope.
Don't lose hope. We can fix it. That's all we have. It will take time, but we'll fix it.
Yeah, that's literally all we have. If you lose hope,
it will start from us. We'll fix it, all right? But
because every damn thing is not working. Every damn thing is not working. Our leaders are there. They're not working. The so-called security that our lives, they're not working. Nothing is working out.
That's what we're trying to fix.
We're forward, Nigeria.
I mean, it begins with talking about it, which is what we're gradually trying to we'll do. Gradually we'll fix it. You know, take it easy, okay? Awareness. But thank you.
Thank you for sharing your experiences. Yeah,
thank you.
You guys are doing a wonderful job. Thank you very much for your
patience.
Thank you. What I was saying to him that, you know, he was saying that it's not the church's job. Like I say, once again, what makes up the church is people. People make up the church. I mean, just because you're in the confines of church, once you step outside of church, you're still dealing with those problems.
Exactly. Hello.
Yeah, good morning. This is Otega calling back.
Okay, Otega. Real quick.
So I want to support what this last caller just said. See, insecurity in this country, our security apparatus, they contribute 90% to it. Because nobody, if a policeman commit crime on the road, other police will cover it up. Well, how do they catch advance? Intelligence. Are they telling me they don't have intelligence reports on all the going around, going on, all the killings going on in the country? They have it because there are people are part of it. They cover it up. The security men, they are not exempted. They are part of the problem. In fact, their own problem is worse than the civilians causing insecurity in this country. Because they are armed and they are not well paid. And they feel people are very big. I don't collect from these people without anybody knowing. They are not causing the problem in this country. It's not like the civilians. Civilians contribute a little. Military men from the army to the police, most especially mobile police men, they are not causing trouble in this country. They should check them. Most of the people go there to join it to use the security apparatus as cover to perpetrate this crime. Because if you're a mobile police, nobody will search you. Nobody will ask why you're carrying a gun. But when you commit this crime, nobody will come and tell you, why are you doing this? They are the problem. Right. I think that's what it starts looking at. Bring these people very well. They are the problem.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so we're talking about getting the government's attention on insecurity. Is protesting the way to go? Getting the government's attention on insecurity. Do you think protesting will be a way to get their attention? Mm-hmm. All right, so yes, he said something about Christians minding their business. That was the last caller before the previous one. That Christians don't really, they should, you know, focus on the church. The truth is...
But the thing is, the Christians are the people.
This is our
business. We are Christians. People are Christians.
Christians, Muslims, I think.
It doesn't matter what religion we are in the country.
Hello?
Exactly.
Hello. Kingsley calling back.
Okay.
Say real quick, what's your point?
Yeah, the last caller said, he said before, he now later call again that most of the problem of this insecurity we are having is from our security. The main problem is for our own people that we say they are guiding us. you know, I used to say there's once I contributed on something like this. I said that there's one of my friends that is a military guy, and he told me all about these things, that their guards are the main people that are causing all these terrorist problems, that they know about it, that if not, terrorists, they are not even up to their power, they will eradicate them, but it is their guards. Sometimes like that, they have information where those people are, but before they get there, their guards will give them information and they will leave that place. Before they get there, they will not find anybody. So I think they are the main problem in this country. Nothing. That's why when I called before, I was asking who are they protesting against, because they should be protesting that this, they should have a particular person that they are protesting against about this insecurity. Like all this, our military chief and whatever, all those general in our forces, they should sack all of them and the problem will be solved. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Well,
he said it.
Okay. So like, that's like, you know, protesting, fine. It could get the attention, but a lot of times, like a couple of people have said, like, okay, take for example, Pastor Adeboye, which is actually a very good thing that he did this prayer walk. You understand? It's actually a commendable stuff. But he has the number of, you know, the vice president, I believe. And if you check, most times when these people want to run for election, they come, they go to all the churches, they seek prayers, they meet them face to face. Don't they talk to them like, okay, what are your plans? Not just coming to pray for the country or pray for them to win the elections.
Mm-hmm.
Don't they question them? Then if you don't even get a proper response, you can either just, I don't know, to me, I believe you shouldn't pray for someone that doesn't have your best interest at heart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Some people will say this is me maybe being a mean Christian. But the truth is, if you don't have the best interest of the people at heart, why should I pray for you to win? Hello?
Yeah. Hello.
Hello. Good morning.
Good morning.
I've been hearing your conversation.
Okay, go ahead.
You two are talking about security and the protest anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I have my own friend view about it. The thing about insecurity and what you have is just the failure of the system. It's a kind of systematic failure. All of us have failed. I used to tell people, it's a problem of all of us.
Yeah.
These kidnappers, these armed robbers, these cultists, these are they not raised in the in our families?
Mm.
Hello.
Hello.
They are all members of one family or the other.
Yeah, true. Mm. Of course.
They have fathers, they have mothers, they have uncles,
they have cousins,
they have aunties. So when we are trying to deal with segregation, we should start dealing with it. Family basis.
Okay. Question every. Okay, go ahead.
People celebrate well. People don't celebrate values anymore and virtues, including me and you.
Mm-hmm, true.
We live in a society that we don't regard somebody who is poor as a human being. Sometimes we take poor people as dogs, including me and you. We are all indicted.
Okay.
And once we don't accord honor and respect to somebody we feel, not that we are a feeling, or we feel that we are better than. All these kind of things will cease to exist. We are so religious, we are so spiritually bereft. Mm. Are you aware?
True.
Even the churches that all like, oh, you know, especially all these new generation churches, they are just a spiritual speaker, they are not preachers. They talk to the congregation what they want to hear. You will be we will fly like this. You will be good. You will be this. God will bless you. Without telling them the consequences of sin.
All right.
Most of these, because they are just spiritual seekers. Those ones who call men of God, they are just spiritual seekers. They are not Christians. Because if you are a Christian, you must act like Christ.
Mm.
Christ respected poor people. Christ respected those who do not have.
Mm. Okay.
Are you aware?
Yeah.
So, dealing with insecurity, we must first of all start respecting everybody we see. Even if it's written in the Bible, if you read somewhere in the book of James, that you that tells a poor man, sit on this corner and give a rich man better seat because he's rich, that you are showing favoritism and you are a wicked person. How many of us are practicing that? We all want to be friends with Dangote. We all want to be friends with governors. We all want to be friends with the governor's wife. We want to be friends with Senator, and we'll be bragging about it.
Okay, so what do you think about, like, do you think protesting is the way to go, or is...
You protest here, we not change anything.
We not change anything, okay. All right.
We're not going to change it. Or till we start respecting everybody.
Okay.
Okay. All right.
Speak or not.
Thank right. you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right.
So I think, do you know what it is? Like I said, I think I've said it before. I tried to make that point so many times that people just don't respect protesting. They don't see the results anymore. But, you know, we tend to see the results outside. I mean, in China, you saw like millions of people came out consistently.
That is a country that cares about their country.
You know,
that,
like,
that is the people that care about their
these
country.
These people, it was a storm. It was a storm outside and they came out in their umbrellas, protesting. Millions of them, you know?
Hello?
Hello.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning. It's Obina Wane calling back. You know, I was saying something before I was cut off.
Okay,
right,
Obina.
Really quickly, Obina, what's your point?
Real quick. All right, go ahead.
What I would say is that church protests will not solve anything. Mm. That is because this is how protests work. When the whole Nigeria, the people who are working, like the union, organized protest and the doctors do not go to work, the engineers and everybody, and the country is shut down economically. The government will listen to such protests. It's not one church, one side the protesting that is going to draw government attention to solve issues.
All right, thank you so much. Although that would be a major, should I say, uproar. Like, if the whole country, everybody decides not to go to work, everybody stays at home, irrespective of what your boss would say, then that is a different level of protest. Then
that when is the solidarity. I think we don't have solidarity.
Yeah.
In this country,
because we always have slides in between. Hello.
Mm-hmm.
Hello.
Yeah. Good morning. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
My name is Israel. I'm calling from the
Scottsdale. Your name is what?
Israel.
Okay, Israel. All right, go ahead.
Okay, now, I have been hearing comments and I'm getting angry.
Don't get angry. Take it easy.
Okay, now, you know, people are kicking against the Redeemed Church protest, or they are backing them up.
Well, everybody's giving their different opinions on it.
I'm just, you know what I think? I know I may get a lot of questions for what I want to say, but I think Nigerians, a lot of us, we are confused.
Okay.
Because some of us went to Twitter yesterday and I was seeing a lot of comments. Actually, I participated in that prayer walk.
Okay.
Yes, this is supposed to be a protest. But as a church, you cannot organize a protest. You know why? Because it's difficult to control human beings. Okay, now you say you want to do protest. In this same church, we have youth that some of them are shout that are being like, I don't mean to use the word shout, but like, you know, with youth, like teenagers, they are usually like, why? That it's difficult to tame them. Now, you gather these people, these are in the church. You cannot segregate them. You can't get that, oh, you can go away, don't go with us for the protest, of which you know these are the future leaders, right? And they are like the workforce in the nation, as far as I'm concerned, right? Now, going with these people, you want to do a protest as a church. It will be difficult for you to control them. Definitely, there's going to be a violence in it. So a church cannot say we are doing protest. Instead, we're going to do the form of a prayer walk. But you are seeing the placard already. The placard is speaking already. So you don't need them. It's going to be difficult for church to do that because in order to avoid violence, that's why they will not want to do that as a protest. So now people are saying, oh, protest is only like, is this not a move? How many other churches are taking a move to do this? If other people now can imitate this and take it and do this, they are going to attract attention. They will attract attention. And this government is trying to, I think the government that is trying to impress, because they came in, I've not seen them deliver anything, honestly speaking. I am not a politician. I cannot go into politics because I just see that the same people from PDP that they're saying they're not doing well, they're doing APC. So I'm not here to discuss politics, but I'm just trying to say Nigerians, we should just get ourselves enlightened a little. We should like do a little research on something before we criticize.
All right.
I believe they should be commenting this church because this is a move. Which church has ever done this?
True.
It's a move. Other church should come into it. Even other church are coming into it. The president or whoever it is will get scared and to make them take a move. Because the team has just done it now, as big as the team is, they've done it. Every single church did it yesterday, I participated. If Living Faith can do that. Deeper Life can do that. Project 20 are doing that. It's going to put fear into these people and they will stand up. Yes, the chief will be fired. I will tell you, I have little experience in the ministry. All right. The military police officers, they are the one that is sponsoring the Boko Haram. Me, my team was sent to escort a military officer to go and visit in Boko Haram in a state in Mugden. I was supposed to go with them, but somebody called me, said, don't go. I dropped your name. I was like, why? He said, don't worry. He's a Christian. They thought he's a Muslim. They do give him information. He said, those team that are going, none of them will come back alive. Do you know they lay ambush on this people? They killed all of them. Only three of them survived.
Wow.
Because they had charms to put them for bullets. They managed to escape. Wow. So the military, they, if they fire this army, this
and okay, since like you have you are sure of this particular thing that goes on behind the scenes, like you and your friend that dropped in, why don't you guys like try and I mean, I don't know, I'm just saying try and follow up.
Do you
maybe
want to get killed? Do you want to get killed? Do you want to get killed? No.
But you know, we keep saying the change starts with us.
How many of us?
That's the thing. Like now, you have information that you think can hurt these people, that can, you know, bring them to book. Don't you think you should try and maybe look for a higher authority? Maybe get a lawyer. You have the likes of Gani and Zagani, rather, Fowles, Falano.
That was like 2013, 2012.
That's when
this thing happened to you.
When
I joined the military, yes, I joined the military when I was that was like 2011. So okay. I was there for 2 years before I left.
Okay, so after that experience, you just left.
Yes, after that experience.
All right.
My
sister
has to. They forced me to leave. That no, we can't do this. We managed to escape this. You don't know the next one that's going to happen.
Because you know I'm saying this because you know we always complain about the decay in the system. You know the rot in the system. What happens behind the scenes? Mm-hmm. Now I've heard some people call in saying the military, and I still find it hard to believe. I'm just saying, since you have been in the military,
yourself,
and you've had this experience, like you were being set up, why can't you follow up with maybe a top lawyer, you know, give him this report, stay anonymous? Do you understand? Like, maybe he can advise you and look for a way you guys can go about it to actually bring these guys to book. That's a way the change can actually start. And we can even know the root of the problem. I'm just saying.
Because
we keep saying, we keep saying, you know, protest, it begins with us. And people that have found themselves in that situation, they back out. Same thing happens to protest. People like when they want to protest and any small threat or anyone wants to not even protest, just maybe take a walk and maybe talk about the insecurity or whatever. Any small threat, everybody's back to their homes or something like that. So if you know these things happen, you are one person that is telling us this. If you've been in the military before, you have experience, why don't you follow up with someone with a higher power authority that can actually bring this thing to book? That way we can start this change or this process of change we always, you know, clamor for.
You know my fear. Now, this person that gave the information and dropped my name,
they're still there.
Right. He's there. Now, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
Now me going to meet a lawyer or whatever, you going to meet a top military or somebody in the authority, you don't even know if that person is
that's what I'm saying. Seek,
you don't know if that person
that's
is
what
a
I'm saying.
Part
seek,
of them.
Seek a lawyer first to give you legal advice on how to go about it before you understand that. Not maybe don't go to the top military people. Just go to a lawyer first. Tell him what's up. Then he advises you on how to go about it.
That was years back, and I didn't really get the information until I left.
Okay.
When I left, I said, "Really, what happened? Why?" It was then I was informed that this is what happened. Actually, when we asked about the team that was dead, people were like, you are doing that. Somebody has told you something, blah, blah, blah. That's what they were saying to me. They were calling me and congratulating me, and I didn't know. It took like a year plus before I knew what was happening. And then I have a lot of friends that have been killed there. I have a lot of them that ran away from that place that have to look for a way to work for their transfer to leave there because they saw the corruption. Now, they told them that these people are in this place. Before you get there, they will lay ambush for you. You are supposed to go and meet people, to go and kill people, to go and attack people. They are the one attacking you. There's a lot going on. These service people now, all of them should be removed and replaced with people. Before those people get corrupted again, because I know they're definitely going to corrupt them because they're going to buy them. There's a lot of money involved. And a lot of people are making money out of this. So before they buy them, at least, they must have done some damage to this. And no service, no head service, they should not allow them to stay more than a year. When they're end of the year, remove them because they'll be able to buy them again.
Okay.
You buy them. Even among the colleagues, you buy some of them. you are going to a battlefield, you are going to face these people, your colleague is shooting, some of them are pushing you forward, some of them are mistaking you. When they notice that this thing is going on, nobody's taking note, they fire you.
Wow, so much expose. Thank you. Well, I don't know what to say about this, but thank you for sharing your experience. And
you
really,
you should go and walk about it. You should go and do something about it. They really want it to stop.
All right, thank you so much.
And this protest is very, very useful. Other churches should imitate it. They should do something about it. Nobody should criticize. They've done their best. This is the best they could do. They cannot call it a protest because, and they cannot speak the protest because it's going to turn violent. So this is the best. In fact, this is a very intelligent move. I believe I encourage other churches to do it, and they should stop criticizing. And Nigeria should stop being confused. We should get. As we should understand the situation before starting commenting. This process is useful. Another strategy should imitate it. That's what I can say about it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
So much, so much, so much, so much going on behind the scenes. But like I keep saying, like we talk about change. But you know, when we are put in a place to actually effect the change, sometimes we get scared.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, like it's a tough one. You know,
it's very hard to go against the grain. Yeah. You know what I mean? Very hard.
We have a message from Tunde on the WhatsApp portal. He goes, as much as people may say the VP is friends with Adeboye and whatnot, he's not the commander in chief and doesn't have the power to sack service chiefs. That power remains in the hands of the president, and the most the VP can do is advise. So even if concerns were raised by church leaders, the list of their quote unquote direct contacts can do is voice their opinions. But the president is still the one in charge. We've seen these church leaders to Villa on numerous occasions and lament on the killings. So, I mean, that's from Tunde on WhatsApp there.
And we have another message on WhatsApp. And this one is from Bamza. I hope I got your name correctly. He said, when I said the U.S. or any other big nation should get involved, I meant it in every sense. I know there are conspiracy theories, like BB raising a point, but trust me, this government's body language doesn't look like the type that would listen to protest. That's why we have the UN and big nations on Security Council that can interfere in smaller nations' problems. Nigeria is too large and strategic, and the UN won't want to risk a breakdown of law and order in the largest country in Africa. About this protesting of a thing, it's sometimes it's actually a welcome development. People keep saying all the churches should get involved, which fine, they should get involved, but not just the churches.
Everyone.
Even the Muslims too.
Because I think this is a time.
Islam is the religion of peace.
Yeah, exactly.
You understand? So they can get involved too. I'm sure when Christians and Muslims come together, you know,
it's powerful.
Let's drop the whole religious talk.
I think putting that to one side, honestly, this is a time that we need to band together as Nigerians, you know, regardless of what religion you are.
Hello.
Hello. Good morning.
Hey, good morning. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
Arnold, calling from Lekki.
All right, Arnold, real quick, go ahead.
Yes, sir, in regards to the last caller, that military guy. So you are saying he should report to the higher authority. Let me ask, can you mention a name? Which of the authorities do you think he should report to? All these guys. I believe that guy. That guy also report. Because if you report, now that it is. The same thing happened to a friend of mine. That he was called to leave a particular place at a particular time. But let me cut the story short anyway. There is nobody to report to. They are all the same. Even those higher authority, they are the one that is financing all the killing and everything. I had an experience when I was in Abuja 2011. Our church was called that they are bringing bombs, that we should be careful. Suicide bomber is coming to our church, of which we took caution of it. And what happened was that same Sunday, because we took caution, military men was outside and everywhere. It was that same Sunday they took that bomb to Christ Embassy at Suleja. So what are you saying? Who is the higher authority we should report to? Who won't die?
Arnold.
Very powerful closing sentiments. Yeah. Who won't die?
Well, nobody wants to, but
it doesn't get realer than that.
It's something that needs to be addressed. I mean, it's scary, like, you know, knowing that you can't even talk to anybody that can even help you or even address the situation. Well, for me, getting the government's attention on insecurity, as much as you know, protesting, they would know. But it's one thing for them to know that, okay, this protest is happening because of insecurity, and them acting on it to actually solve the problem of insecurity. Already it's causing a lot of, you know, chaos in the Ninth Assembly. You know, we had into Abari Bey, who was challenging this present government, and it was their major selling point when they were coming into power, that they would handle insecurity. The Boko Haram would be you know, wiped off the surface of Nigeria. They made us promises.
Yep.
And now
promises
it's like,
that they haven't adhered
to. You understand? They've not fulfilled. It's like it's gotten worse. So we demanding, you know, solutions for this problem of insecurity. It's long overdue.
It is. And like you said earlier, you know, if the Muslims got involved as well, it is not a Christian issue. It is not a Muslim issue. It is not a whatever other religion issue.
Orisha.
It is a people issue. Exactly. You know what I mean?
It really doesn't matter.
It really doesn't matter where you come from, what you do, what your job is, whatever it is. If you are a human being and if you are a member of this so-called country, you have a right to protest and you have a right to stand together and want better for yourself and want better for the country, doesn't regardless of what institution you're under. You know what I mean? So I think this whole, the church shouldn't do this and the church shouldn't do that, it's a human issue. And also, I think one thing we always forget as well, the church is not a museum for the perfect. It's a hospital for the sick. Mm. You know, it is not for perfect people. It is for helping people.
All right, this will be our last call and we'll wrap it up. Hello?
Hello. Yeah, it's Matthias calling back from Ajegunle.
Okay.
Hey, AJ.
All right, go ahead.
You see, at least this is a security problem. Like, I was going to call and say, I talked about family. Their families are not living up to their responsibility. Have we agreed on that?
Agreed on...
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear
that
you.
That families are not living up to their responsibility. Every criminal comes from a family.
Well, true.
Of course.
Sadly, but true.
Yeah, almost all the criminals have an affiliation with one religion or the other.
Okay, true.
Especially, as we say, almost all of us are Muslim and Christian. And these two major religions condemn crime and criminality.
True.
How come there are so many criminals on the street? You know, see, one thing about we in this part of the country, I'm from the East, is that we are downplaying security situation even here in Lagos.
Yeah, true. Actually, I think so.
Crimes are very much underreported in Lagos. I see that as a kind of mischief from you people in the media.
Okay. Why so? Yeah, we can hear you.
Just last week, a woman was almost beheaded in Ajegunle. And in Laika area of Ajegunle. And his bag was, her bag was like, just carrying her all that handbag around 10 o'clock in the night. Mm. And it happens in all parts of Lagos. Autism an issue in all parts of Lagos. Ajao, Somolo, Ajegunle, Musho. People are being killed every day. And it doesn't make headlines. Mm. But if one person dies in Benue or one person dies in Kaduna, we hold papers because we in the South here, especially the Southwesterners, control the media. So they use it as a tool for mischief.
Okay, so in other words, they don't report things that go on in Lagos to make Lagos.
They report. Okay, when Bado caught, we are killing families, wiping families away in the
Ikorodu was reported.
How many times did it make headlines?
It was actually reported a lot of times.
It did not make any headlines.
It actually did.
Let us be very frank to ourselves.
No, I get your point. Like, they are making Lagos look like a role model for states out there. Like, there's not.
And sometimes I have a younger brother who's a journalist like you anyway.
Yeah.
But sometimes I used to attack him. So why are you people so ridiculous? You don't even kick yourselves because a journalist is always right. A journalist is always seen as a saint because they can take over other person. I'm sorry that I'm digressing. Let me digress a bit again. Because they are the one that tries every other profession, but they don't criticize themselves. That's the height of hypocrisy. So coming down to that insecurity, we can only tackle this security problem if we start placing the right values starting from family.
Mm.
Now, mothers and fathers accept anything from their children if their children are doing well without even profiling the source of the income. Children now come home with Bentley, with bells of all sorts, renting house in choice areas in Lagos without their family profiling them. Their family, their family has, family has mother and father. Is it not happening in Lagos here? Somebody don't have a job green. Like, there are many in this area. They don't have work green. They spend their time in their palace, drinking for money tonight, driving cars, and they have mothers, they have fathers. That is not an issue. Yeah, we people should start doing a thorough job, especially journalism, reporting matters as truth as it is.
Yeah, we do that,
the
man. But thank
you. Giving you power to change the society. It is in your hands.
Thank you for highlighting that. But actually, we do that a lot on this program, and we highlight the ills of society. But thanks for your, you know,
thanks
opinion
for your
on
input.
This.
Yeah.
All
shout
right,
out to you.
And yeah, we'll do.
Have a nice day.
All right,
all right. Have a good
you.
One.
All right, so we're wrapping up this topic. Let me read this
message on the WhatsApp portal. Go ahead.
This one says, "Hello guys, well done. This is from Shanti. This is Nigeria. Everything is not right. All sectors are deeply messed up. For the caller that you say he should follow up, he should not try to." Following up is putting his life at risk and the person you want to confide in. How sure are you that they are not in the same club, hereby exposing yourself because of one year country? Mm. He should just lay low and continue what he's doing. And that's from Shanti. All right.
Wow.
Yeah. So I was just wrapping up. So shout out to everybody that has participated in the show today. From all the calls to the text messages that we received, it's clearly a topic that affects all of us here as Nigerians. It's a topic that, regardless of your religion, regardless of where you are from, this is something that, you know, I think, needless to say, we need to stand together and, you know, raise awareness for this together. And I do think that peaceful protests are the way forward in at least raising awareness.
And consistency. I think that's what it is. Like, peaceful protest, but make sure it's consistent and it's peaceful.
Cool.
It doesn't matter if you're Christian, Muslim, whatever other religion, it doesn't matter if you're Hausa, Yoruba, Igbo, Edo,
doesn't matter.
It's people. It's a people
exactly.
problem. It is not, you know, one particular race or one particular society or one particular class. It is a people problem and we all need to band together.
Yep, yeah. And let's not be selfish, because sometimes even these protests are being led by people that have hidden agendas and, you know, other reasons why they're protesting, maybe for political to climb up the political ladder. I've seen a lot of these protests happen in Nigeria, and at the end of the day, you find out the person spearheading these protests has one political agenda. Next, you hear the person running for presidency, you're running for one office, and he or she wins. And all the protests he has done in the past, he forgets it.
Yeah.
So he has used other people's, efforts or sweat or blood to climb up the ladder. And forgetting whatever he promised the people or whatever he stood for in the past. I don't want to call names, but a lot of people that we've celebrated today in this particular government, some of them started as protesters. As, one, in short, God help us.
It's okay.
Coffee Gang.